إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في الكتاب الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال عز وجل يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما وقال سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم آمين أما بعد. We begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by praising Him, by glorifying Him. And we begin by exalting His glory and we begin by mentioning His perfection and His names. All the beautiful names Allah says belongs to Him. All the beautiful names belongs to Allah. All the beautiful attributes belongs to Allah. All the attributes of perfection belongs to Allah. And the creation that Allah has created is a reflection of these attributes. And one of the scholars said, the world of multiplicity, with all the different things that's in it, the harmony is the signature of Allah's oneness. So when you see how the bees and the flowers go together, and how the rain and the plants go together, and how the day and the night go together, and how the male and the female go together, and all these different things, even though they look worlds apart, they function precisely with each other in perfect harmony. This is a sign that the one who created all of this and the one who created all of this is the one and the same. And so we begin by sending peace and blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this a gathering of blessing, and make this a gathering of mercy, and make this a gathering of learning and benefit for our dunya and akhirah. Alhamdulillah. One of the ayahs in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the reality of this world, about the nature of this world. Because sometimes as we go through the life, we have our good times and bad times, and we have our families, growing families, increasing wealth, and all these different things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسَ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do you really think that the people are going to say, I believe in Allah, and we're not going to test them? Right, so the nature of this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ. Definitely we're going to test you with some fear and some hardship and some loss and some difficulties. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights that, yes, you are in the mercy of Allah. You are living in the world that is created because of the mercy of Allah. And one of our scholars said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is the keys to the creation. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had started the Quran by saying, Bismillah al-Wahid al-Qahhar, in the name of Allah, the one and only, and the dominant, nothing would have existed. But the creation happens because Allah said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allah declared His mercy, He called Himself Rahman. And when Allah is the merciful, there is something that has to be there for Allah to show mercy. And so the world was created, and the reality of the Prophet ﷺ was created. And all this creation, all this kaun and zaman and everything came into existence so Allah could show us He is a Rahman. But while you're living in this world, a Rahman, He says, I'm going to test you. Because here's the reality. You are living in Allah's mercy. All around you is mercy. Everything you have is mercy. But sometimes Allah will give you a taste of hardship. Allah will give you a taste of loss. Allah will give you a taste of difficulties. What's going to be your reaction? Let's see. Even the Prophet ﷺ, his own family, they went through hardships. And one of the famous hadith about the situation the Prophet ﷺ fell into with his family, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, you know, when the Prophet used to go into his ghazawat, he used to draw lots between his wives. And every time he would take one of us with him, and this time it happened to be in my favor, so I went with the Prophet ﷺ. She said the ghazwa finished and the journey finished and we were on the way back. The caravan camped before we entered Medina. So they stopped someplace and they were camping. And she says, radiallahu anha, that she had to go and answer the call of nature. So she went far away into the desert. And when she came back, she said they used to carry her in this little palanquin type of thing. She said, when I came back, I realized my necklace was missing, made of onyx and carnelian, you know, the aqiq. So she said, I went back looking for it. And by the time she found it and came back, the army had gone. And she starts giving excuses to the people. She said, in those times, the women didn't, they were not very heavy. We used to eat one or two morsels of food a day. So when they picked up the palanquin and put it on the camel, they didn't think, why is it so light? And she said, I was a young girl, I was very skinny. So she's giving excuses to them. You know, they left me behind. No. She said that she came to the desert, all around her, vast, empty desert. And all the army is gone. So she said, I went to the place where I was waiting, and I just sat down and I waited. I left my affairs with Allah. She said, as I was waiting, I fell asleep. So she fell asleep in the desert. Huge, vast desert. As far as the eyes can see, is sand. The sky, open blue, not a cloud in sight. And the army is gone. The Sahaba are gone. Prophet ﷺ is gone. She is alone by herself. And one of the other companions of the Prophet ﷺ, Safwan radiallahu anhu, he had lagged behind in a previous stop. So he was catching up with the army. And when he arrived, he said, you know, he saw a figure of a person sleeping. So he walked up and he recognized Aisha radiallahu anha. Because she said he had seen me before the obligation of hijab had come down. As soon as he saw me, he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. When a musibah hits you, when a calamity hits you, what do we say? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Sometimes you can see calamities coming to you from far away. And Safwan radiallahu anhu, he noticed, I'm by myself in the desert. There is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Zawjatu Rasulullah. He exclaimed and he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. She said, I woke up at his saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So as he covered her face, he brought his camel and kneeled it down. She got on top of the camel and she said, he led the camel and I ride. And the whole time he didn't say anything, I didn't say anything. And except that he kept saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Until they arrived to Medina, they caught up with the armies. She said, after she entered Medina, she fell sick. And Medina had a fever it was known for. People that were not used to the climate of Medina, when they enter Medina, they would become sick. And sometimes that illness would take about a month or 2 months, and some people would die from this. So Aisha radiallahu anha, when she entered Medina, she said she became ill, and she was in her home, and the ladies were taking care of her for a month. She didn't leave the house. And she said she noticed something change about the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to treat her. Before she would become sick, the Prophet would come and sit with her and talk to her and all these things. He said, after I became sick, the Prophet would come in the door and he would say, how's your lady? Talking to the woman, taking care of her. And they would say, she's well, Ya Rasulullah, she's getting better, Ya Rasulullah, and he would leave. So she's confused what's going on. Meanwhile, outside, the hypocrites started concocting stories. And we love scandals. We love scandals, right? We love stories. And so the hypocrites start concocting stories. Oh, we saw her come from the desert alone, this. And they start fabricating lies and spreading rumors. And things got so heavy, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even the way he treated his wife changed, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah knows she's innocent. But when people start spreading rumors and lies, it has effects on the hearts. Even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not immune from this. And so a month passes by, and Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, she started to get better, and she went with Misbah. So she went out with her to a place in the desert to answer the call of nature. She said, on the way back, the woman she was with tripped. And she started cursing her son. May Miftah be, destroyed, may he be this. And she said, what are you saying? Are you, you know, accusing or are you abusing someone who is present with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the Battle of Badr, let alone your own son? She said, do you not know what he's saying about you? She said, no, what's going on? And this is, you know, one of the things, you know, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us about. In order to contain the damage of scandals and all these other things, there is ghibah and there is namima, and there is buhtan. Buhtan is false accusations, right? Ghiba is speaking about somebody behind their back, that's true. What's the sin for that? Prophet ﷺ said, whoever does ghiba, it's like eating the flesh of their brother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَتُحِبُّونَ أَن يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ. Do you love to eat the flesh of your brother while he's dead? No, but you won't like it, so don't speak behind their back like this. The Sahaba said, what if it's true, Ya Rasulullah? He said, if it's true, it's ghiba. If it's not true, it's buhtan, it has greater sin. So she says to him, do you know what they're saying about you? And this is namima. Oh, you know what so-and-so said about you? Spreading the news, bringing the news. And we love to do that sometimes, right? Call somebody up, say, man, I was at this gathering, and you guess what they're saying about your children? Guess what they're saying about your son? Guess what they're saying about your daughter? And what happens? Ignites fires, makes fights in families, and people break up relationships because somebody came and said, do you know what they're saying about you? But she spills the news to Aisha radiallahu anha, and Aisha radiallahu anha, she cannot believe what she's hearing. She cannot comprehend what's being said about her. Allah calls her in the Quran, you know, those who accuse believing women who are ghafilat, naive, care, you know, heedless about the evils in the world. Not ghafil in the sense that they don't know what, they're clueless about the things, the evil that people have the capacity to do. They see good in everything. They see good in everyone. When they get hit with something like this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَحْسَبُونَهُ هَيِّنًا. You thought this is a small thing. وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. But with Allah, this is a huge matter. Right? So you have people going through other people's Instagrams and other things looking for something to start scandals about. What's so-and-so's daughter up to? Did you hear they took off their hijab? You know, I wonder what she's doing this, what she's doing that. You know, when you have things like this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, why then, when somebody comes to you with things like this, say, subhanallah, this is not something for us to talk about. Why don't you have good opinion of the believers in your heart and say, هذا بحتان عظيم, this is a great accusation. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts, you know, admonishing the people. But she said she went home and she got even more sick. She got even more sick. And the Prophet ﷺ came and he asked, how is your lady? And she said, before anybody answered, she said, I asked the Prophet ﷺ, give me permission to go to my parents' house. She said she wanted to confirm the news with her parents. So the Prophet ﷺ said, you have permission. She went to her father, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. The Prophet ﷺ told us about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. If the entire Ummah's deeds was placed on one side of the scale, and Abu Bakr's deeds was placed on the other side of the scale, whose outweighs whose? Abu Bakr's outweighs the entire. So imagine, this is the family of Muhammad ﷺ, the daughter of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And she goes to her family. And she says to her mother, is this true? Is this what people are saying? She says, oh Aisha, there is no woman who's beautiful and has, you know, husband that have other wives that somebody might plot and try to harm her. There is jealousy and things. And she is shocked in that. She cannot believe it. So she stays with them. Meanwhile, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he doesn't know what to make of the situation. There is no revelation. There is no wahi coming down. And the streets are filled with rumors and gossip, and the Prophet ﷺ is hurting. He doesn't know to trust his family or not to trust his family. So he calls the Sahaba and he starts asking for Ali radiallahu anhu one of the other Sahaba for advice. What do you think? Should I divorce my wife? Should I stay with her? And they give their opinions. And finally the Prophet ﷺ, he gets up in front of all the people in the minbar. He says, who's going to help me against the man who's hurting me and my family? Right? The one who was spreading the rumors, generating these things, was a guy named Abdullah bin Ubay. He was a leader of the hypocrites. So the Prophet ﷺ says, and they're accusing my family, and I know nothing about my family except good. And he did his investigation. He went and he asked the other wives, do you know anything about Aisha that would make you suspicious? One of them said, Ya Rasulullah, I know nothing bad about her except she's young. Sometimes when she's making dough, she falls asleep. And the goats come and eat the dough. Right? Another one said, I know nothing bad about her. Like all of them, even the ones that were competing with Aisha, they said, Ya Rasulullah, I know nothing about her except what is good. So all these testimonies, still the Prophet ﷺ, his heart has been affected. Right? All these rumors, they have an effect. We know these people think when you say things has no people, you can destroy families with your words. You can cause people to go to great lengths of harm with your words. We have to be very careful. Some of the cultures, some of the families, when they have this kind of disgrace and shame come to them, you know what they resort to? Because they don't have the calm understanding and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, they end up hurting their daughters. They end up hurting their families. Because why? Because what are people saying about you? What is this? What is that? And they take small things and they blow it out of proportion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you have four witnesses, then say something. If you don't have four witnesses, you shut your mouth. Because you, in front of Allah, you will be the liar one. Even if you saw it with your own eyes. Right? So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he says this, you know, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu stands up and he says, Ya Rasulullah, if he's from my tribe, I will kill him for you myself. And if he's from our brothers, you know, we will do with him what you tell us to do with him. In other words, he doesn't want to overstep the tribal boundaries. Somebody in the other tribe doesn't like it. So their leader stands up and says, by Allah, you will never kill him and you will never be able to, because we will fight you and we will defend him. Somebody else stands up and says, you are a hypocrite defending a hypocrite. Now tribal wars are being ignited between Aus and Khazraj, because somebody is spreading rumors about the family of the Prophet ﷺ. Aus and Khazraj is about to fall apart. The unity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had brought, you know, وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى حُفْرَةٍ مِنَ النَّارِ فَانْقَذَكُمْ مِنْهَا, Allah says, you used to be on the brink of hellfire, Allah saved you from it. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا, and by His favor, He brought your hearts close together, He made you brothers. Right? They're about to destroy all of this. Because see how shaitan works. Shaitan spreads rumors under the things, starts spreading false accusations, starts creating ill feelings towards each other. So now it's getting escalating. The Prophet ﷺ, he calms the Sahaba down, he takes them out of the city, they march the whole day until everybody's tired. They come home, they pass out. Rasulullah ﷺ goes to his wife and he says to her, oh Aisha, now you know what's going on. If you did nothing wrong and you're innocent, then Allah will prove your innocence. But if you did something wrong, then do istighfar with Allah. She says the whole time she was crying. She was crying. She couldn't hold back her tears. Imagine somebody saying things like this about you and your family. Like, what do you go through? Right? And she's a young girl. She has no idea about what's going on. And suddenly there's this huge stigma on her reputation. And people are looking at her funny. Her own husband is not treating her the way he used to. And he's the messenger of Allah. Right, so she was crying the whole time. She says, I thought my mom and dad thought my liver is going to burst. And they had some kind of idea that if you cry too much, your liver will burst. So when the Prophet ﷺ says this to her, she says, my tears just stopped dry. And she said, I told the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, you've been listening to this talk so much that it has found its place. And if I tell you I'm innocent, you're not going to believe me. And if I tell you, you know, I'm not innocent, even though Allah knows I'm innocent, then you're likely to believe me. So she said, I don't know much of the Quran, but one thing came to my mind, what the father of Yusuf alayhi salam said. What the father of Yusuf alayhi salam said. She said, Sabrun Jameel, Wallahu Musta'an. And she just turned away. She just looked away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she went to her bed and she covered herself. Now mind you, they're in the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr is right there, his mother, you know, his wife is right there. Aisha just laid down, she turned her back to the Prophet ﷺ. And Rasulullah ﷺ is sitting there. And she said, I had no doubt in my mind, in my heart, that at that moment, Allah was going to clear my reputation. And Allah is going to show the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam my innocence. But she said, I didn't think I was important enough that Allah was going to reveal Quran. That will be recited for a long time after. You know, she said, I thought maybe the Prophet will see a dream or something. But right then and there, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam starts receiving revelation. Right, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts sending revelation. And his, you know, all the effects of revelation when the Prophet would get wahi starts taking over him. And the small pearls, like beads of sweat, starts forming. She describes it like pearls start falling. Whether in hot days or cold days, this would happen to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he says, glad tidings to you, Aisha. Allah has absolved your name. Allah has proven, Allah has, you know, spoken in your defense. And Abu Bakr and the mother of Aisha, she says, tell the Prophet ﷺ, thank you. She says, I'm not going to thank anybody except Allah. Right? She's still with Allah. This is the realization. Is that when these difficulties come, when these challenges come, who's going to lift them off from you? Who's going to expel them away from you? Right? Who's going to give you ease? Allah. And then at that moment, she realized even the Prophet ﷺ cannot, because he was being affected by the people's rumors. And when Allah revealed the verses, he was smiling. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who come to you with these things, these are a group amongst you. Right? They love, there's some of you, your family members, there's a group amongst you, they love scandals. They love fitna. They are the instigators of fitna. And you have to be aware of them. And you don't have to take it to heart. And you know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when one of the relatives of him started spreading rumors like this, he used to help him out. He used to give money. A guy was poor. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, in defense, he said, I am never going to spend money on this person again. He took an oath. Imagine somebody spread rumors about your daughter. What will you do? Say, I'm not going to spend money on him anymore. You'll take a shotgun to his house. Right? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, I'm not going to spend money on him anymore. Allah says to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and those of you who used to excel in doing good and spend from your wealth, who have been given wealth, right? Don't stop the khayr because of this. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? And don't you want Allah to forgive you? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is guiding the hearts of the believers on how to handle these scandals, how to go through these situations. And finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. O people of Iman, لا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان. Don't follow the footsteps of Shaytan. إنما يأمركم بالفحشاء والمنكر. You know, whoever follows the footsteps of Shaytan, know that Shaytan always commands you to shamelessness and for evil things. There are people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who love for shamelessness to spread amongst the believing communities. They love for these things to spread amongst the believing communities. Allah has prepared a special punishment for them. Right? Don't go around snooping on people's profiles to look at what kind of things they have so you can expose their flaws. So you can expose their faults. So you can accuse them and say, you know, look what so-and-so's daughter is doing. That's not your business. That's not your business. And then those that have been giving daughters, Allah has given you daughters. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever has raised two daughters and they did their best to teach them iman, to teach them akhlaq, to teach them adab, and they didn't prefer their sons over their daughters, they're guaranteed Jannah. Whoever is given three daughters. And one sahabi said, Ya Rasulullah, what about two daughters? He said, even if they have two daughters. And the commentary says, if somebody had said, what about someone who has one daughter? The Prophet ﷺ would have said, even if they have one daughter. Why? Because this is the honor of your family. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a blessing. And as the daughters grow older, as they get mature, the father and their hearts, it's a different world. Right? They don't see the world as, because, you know, for them, it's about protecting my family. It's about doing the best for my family. And when the human being gets older, they have free will, they have choice, they have all these other things. And you have all these people starting fitna. And sometimes you have naive people falling into fitna. How do you handle that? Do you disown your children? Do you throw them off to the side? Or do you have mercy on them? The Prophet ﷺ told Aisha, Oh Aisha, If you did something wrong, do istighfar, and Allah will forgive you. If you did nothing wrong, Allah will prove your innocence. She didn't like that, of course, because she was what? She was innocent. But if somebody is not innocent and they have fallen into sin, still what? Is the doors of Tawbah open or closed? Alhamdulillah for that. Alhamdulillah for that. And so we have to protect each other, and we have to protect our honor, and we have to be kind and compassionate to our families. And we have to, as the Prophet ﷺ said, رِفْقًا بِالْقَوَارِيرِ. Be kind and gentle with the fragile ones. Right? And qawarir is a pottery that's easy to break. The Prophet ﷺ told us, treat your woman the way you treat a fragile piece of dishware. If you can break it by mishandling it. And so you have to be kind and compassionate, and you have to be understanding, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower us with His mercy and to increase us our iman. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين استفى أما بعد. One of the mercies the Prophet ﷺ gave us, he said, a judge cannot judge with his own knowledge. In other words, if a judge saw a crime happen, he cannot be a judge. He can come as a witness, but not as a judge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows everything. But on the day of judgment, He has made it His sunnah. He's not going to judge based on His knowledge. He's going to judge based on what? Witnesses. And if Allah wants to get someone, Allah will make them a witness against themselves. And if Allah wants to forgive someone, Allah will hide their sins and cover it and not expose it. And so don't expose your sins. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is told in that surah, if somebody accuses anyone, if they don't bring four witnesses, let them be quiet and don't take any more testimony from them again. In fact, whip them 80 times. How dare you accuse somebody's honor? How dare you accuse somebody's dignity? How dare you accuse somebody's reputation? This is, Allah says, وَتَحْسَبُونَهُ حَيِّنًا. You thought this is a small thing. But with Allah, it's what? It's azim. It's a big thing. It's a major thing. And so, alhamdulillah, that one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Sittir. Sattar. You know what that means? The one who provides covering and veiling. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah forgives everyone to whom Allah has covered their sins, as long as they don't go out in the morning and expose themselves. If someone commits a sin at night, and they hide it, and they make tawbah, and they make istighfar, right? Allah will not punish them, because Allah is merciful, Allah is covering for them, until they go and remove Allah's veils themselves. A man from the children of Israel, Bani Israel, used to sin and commit all kinds of atrocities. And what happened? For 40 years, the rain stopped coming after that. Musa alayhi salam, everybody's asking Allah for rain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to his prophet, oh my prophet Musa, there is one person amongst you, he has been transgressing for too long. And because of his deeds, because of his evil, I have withheld the rain. When he makes tawbah and when he's brought forth, then I'll bring the rain back. Prophet Musa alayhi salam, he's got strong presence. He gets up and he says, who is that person who's doing this? Who is that person who's doing that? And he's looking at everyone. He wants to find the culprit and make him go, because everybody's suffering because of one person's sins. A man sitting in the crowd, he's scared. Oh my God, I'm about to get exposed. I'm about to get exposed. Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam said, if you expose people, if you are even hiding in your own house, Allah will expose you. If you cover people, then Allah will cover for you. So this man, Allah had mercy on him. He's thinking, I'm about to get exposed. And he starts making tawbah. Ya Allah, forgive me. Don't expose me. Ya Allah, hide my sins. Ya Allah, cover me. And as soon as he's making tawbah, the Prophet Musa alayhi salam is like, who is this? Rain starts coming. La ilaha illallah. Everybody's like, what's going on? Musa alayhi salam goes to the Tor and he starts asking Allah, Ya Allah, You said there was a person doing this, and you said the rain wouldn't come until we deal with him. He didn't come out. And the rain came. What happened? He said, oh, my prophet Musa, that's between me and my servant. That's between me and my servant. He asked for my forgiveness, I forgive him. La ilaha illallah. The rain starts. So Musa alayhi salam said, Ya Allah, who was it? Who was it? I just want to know. He said, oh Musa, the man was sinning for 40 years, I didn't expose him. And now that he's made tawbah, you want me to expose him? La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cover our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cover our shame. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our honor, protect our dignity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us great in the eyes of the people and insignificant in our own eyes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise our families in a state of iman and taqwa. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the khutuwat of shaitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the fitna makers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from all those who intend to harm the families of the believers. May Allah Ya Rabbil Alameen, we ask you to shower us with your mercy, Allah. Forgive our sins, Ya Allah. Ya Rabbil Alameen, increase us in iman, Ya Allah. Ya Rabbil Alameen, we ask you to make us of those whose hearts are like the heart of the Prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Allah. And we ask you, Ya Rabbil Alameen, make us of those who die in a state of iman, with their last words being, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, wa sallallahu alayhi Sayyidina Muhammad, wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, wa akhir da'wana, alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Amin. Aqimus salam.